Hello everyone, welcome to the online lecture series on Verilog HDL. So in the previous sessions we had started off with module 2 and we had seen what are the different types of data types which are available in Verilog. So in today's session we shall start off with the system tasks and compiler directives which are available in Verilog. How actually these are being very useful when we are writing the test benches or when we are testing the functionality of our design. Okay, so coming to the learning outcomes, at the end of the session a student will be able to explain the different types of system tasks and compiler directives which are available in Verilog. So now let us look into which are the different types of system tasks which are available in Verilog. Now one is dollar display, and the keyword for us, see, any system task is given by, it has to be started with what? It has to be started with a dollar symbol, and it has, after dollar we need to give what? We need to give keyword. For example, you can see over here a display system task is being invoked by giving what? By initializing it with a dollar symbol, and then we need to give the name, what we what is the keyword name which is given in terms of Verilog. So one is dollar display and the other is dollar monitor. So now let us look into these, what actually these things does and what are the syntax we need to write so that we can execute these dollar display and then dollar monitors. Now coming to where actually these dollar display and dollar monitors are being used, basically we use these type of system tasks while writing the test benches. Okay, this is same way what you have written in terms of your C programs. Like suppose if you want to check any what we can say, if you are executing some program and you want to see what are the values or the values which need to be printed on in the screen while you are compiling. So what actually we are doing, suppose let us take an example of C. So we are using the statement called as printf. Okay, so printf, what it does, it takes the variable value, and that variable, whatever the variable what we are giving, it takes the value from that particular variable, and at the instant of time, at what time scale we are giving that particular value, at that particular instant of time what is the value of that particular variable, that is going to be displayed on the screen. So both does the same job here, dollar display and then dollar monitor, these does the same job as the printf statement in your C does. Okay, but there are some differences. Okay, now let, and we have another set of things that is called as dollar stop and then dollar finish. Okay, let us look into these one by one, what actually these particular system tasks do. Okay, now let us look into dollar display statement. So dollar display is the main system task for displaying the values or variables or strings or expressions. Okay, now coming to the syntax. Okay, now here the syntax is, first what we should do, we need to invoke this particular symbol, and that is being given by what? It is being given by dollar display, and then we need to give the variable names. It does not mean that I should only give the variable names as well. If you want to print any sentences, and then if you want to, like, let us look at the C program what you can write. Okay, for this particular C program, if you want to print any statement, so what you will be doing, you will be writing something like this, printf. Okay, let me write this is as printf, and then you will be writing some, the value of A is percentage D, and then here you will write what, here you will be writing this A, right? So this is what, this is a similar syntax, but if you want to write in the example of the slide what we had seen for Verilog dollar display, we had seen something like this, dollar display. Okay, and then we had written something called p1 p2 and it goes on till pn, right? So it does not mean that we should write only the variable names, or else we can use something like this dollar display. Okay, and then in the similar fashion how actually we have written, we will be writing the value of p1 is, and then here I'll be giving what, here I'll be giving percentage d, and then I'll be displaying this can be percentage d or percentage b. D stands for what here? D stands for the decimal. If you want to display the values in terms of binary, then you will be replacing it with what? You will be replacing it with b. Okay, and then you will be giving what? You will be giving the variable name here. Okay, now if you look at this, this is almost similar to the printf statement what we are having. In the similar fashion we are having, we will be writing all these things, and then at end we will be writing what? We will be writing the variable name. So both the it is similar to that itself. So let us suppose now here in C program what we will be writing, we will be including the new line format by giving backslash and then n, but the new line will be inserted at end of every dollar display statement by default. There is no need, there is no requirement of giving backslash n for the dollar display statement. Okay, now here we are having different types of formats like what and all you need to display. Now here you can observe, for decimal format, if you want to display any decimal values, then we will be writing what? We will be writing percentage d. And in the similar fashion, if you are going for binary values, then we will be giving it as what? Percentage b. And if you want to display any strings, then it will be giving percentage s, and then hex, and then ASCII characters, and then hierarchical names, and the display strength, variable in octal, and then the time format, and the in terms of scientific form, and then in terms of real form, and then in terms of what? In terms of scientific or decimal, whichever is shorter. So these are the different types of things. We basically will be using all these values, where we will be using these values over here at this point. Okay, this particular point. Okay, so if you want to display decimal, then we'll be writing it in terms of the percentage d. If you want to display in terms of binary, we'll be replacing this particular value with what? This particular value will be displayed in terms, will be replaced with, if you want in terms of binary, then I'll replace it with what? I'll replace it with percentage b. And if I want something to be displayed in terms of hexadecimal, so then I will be replacing it with what? Percentage H. Okay. So this is what actually the dollar display does. Now, let us look into some of the examples over here. Here you can observe dollar display hello verilog world. Okay. Now you can see that if I want to display any strings, then what I'll be doing? I'll be giving this particular sentence in terms of quoted form, okay, double quoted form. Suppose if you want to display any time, okay, now at what time or at what simulation time does this value occurs for some particular variable, then I'll be giving what? I'll be giving dollar display and then dollar time. Again here what? Dollar is in order to display the things, and then here we are telling what? We are telling in terms of you display the time. Okay, now let us look in terms of this. Here we are having, now if you look at this particular example over here, here we are having a resistor with the name port underscore id. Okay, and this port underscore id is of how many bits? It is of 5 bits, because here we have given 3 down to 0 in the sense 4 down to 0 in the sense 4 3 2 1 and then 0, so total 5 bits. Okay, now here what we are telling, instead of just displaying a dollar display and then port id, we are specifying it with what? Id of the port is percentage b, and then we are displaying it with what? What is the name what we have given over here? Okay, now suppose if the port id value is 0101, here you can see that Here ID of the port is 00101 and then port ID. Okay, this port ID won't be displayed only till this much part. ID of the port is 00101, till here it will be displayed. Okay, now let us look into another function. Now dollar monitor, what it does, this does the same job. Both dollar display also displays the thing and dollar monitor also displays the thing. Okay, now the major difference between dollar display and dollar monitor is, now if you like what we can see, this dollar display, suppose if I have written some program, I have written a test bench and then I have called dollar display only once. Okay, or let us consider that we have called this dollar display twice in our program. So the dollar display statement will be executed only once. Okay, so where actually you are calling that dollar display statement, right, only at that particular instant the dollar display statement will be executed. Suppose if you have called two number of times in your program, then the dollar display will be executed twice in the execution. But whereas dollar monitor, as it says monitor, that means this will keep on monitoring the values. Okay, whenever there are changes in the input values, then the dollar monitor will be executed. Whenever there are changes in the output values, then the dollar this the dollar monitor will be executed. Suppose say let us say that I'm not displaying all the values. Okay, now we had seen an example over there, like port ID, we had called ID of the port is percentage B and then comma port ID we had seen. Okay, now for that particular port, whenever there is a change in the ports, now we had seen that particular in terms of dollar display, where that particular port value is when we had called that particular port value is 00101. Now if I make the same statement in terms of, instead of giving it as dollar display, if I give it as dollar monitor, then what will happen? Every time whenever the port ID value changes, then the statement will be, the display statement will be executed. No difference at all. Dollar display executes only one number of time, whereas dollar monitor, whenever there are changes in the variables which we want to display, whenever there is a change in the variable, or whenever there is a change in the value of the variable, then that particular port, that particular statement will be executed. Okay, this is the main difference. Now let us look into the syntax. It is same as dollar monitor, and then we will be giving the sentences over here. And as dollar display does, the dollar monitor also inserts a new line after execution of any statement. Okay, so unlike dollar display, dollar needs to be invoked only once. Okay, so here what does this particular line meant? That so I need not keep on writing whenever I want to invoke any display statement. At the end of the session, what I'll do, I'll keep one dollar monitor statement at the end of my program, so that there is no requirement of inserting this dollar monitor everywhere in the program. What you can do, you can write the whole test bench and all those things, and then you can write at the end which variable. Suppose if you're testing for some variable name, then you can display that statement at the end of your before end module. Okay, at the end of that particular line, you need to insert the dollar monitor. So dollar monitor takes care of all the things. Now let us look into this. Now here, if you look at this particular program, so here what you are having, the dollar monitor, and then we are invoking the time here, dollar time, and the value of signals clock is equal to percentage B and reset is equal to percentage B, and then we are invoking what? We are invoking two different things, two different variables, that is one is clock and then one more is reset. Now if you look at this, at 0th instant of time, the clock is 0 and then reset 1. At 5 nanoseconds, the clock is 1 and then reset is 1, and at 10 nanoseconds clock is 0 and then reset is 0. So every time whenever the values changes, at the same time the dollar monitor, what it is going to do, it is going to display the sentence what you have given in the dollar monitor state. Okay, so this is all regarding dollar display and then dollar monitor. Now let us look into dollar stop and dollar finish. Similar fashion, how we have two different variables or two different keywords in Verilog. One is dollar display and then dollar monitor, where dollar display is going to be executed only once, whereas dollar monitor keeps on monitoring whenever there are changes in the values. In the similar fashion, when we are doing simulation, if you want to halt at some point, suppose I am executing, I am giving these many number of combinations of inputs and I want to halt a little bit, so what I can do, I can use this particular keyword dollar stop. So dollar stop, what it is going to do, it is going to be provided to stop during the simulation. Okay, so this, what it does, it is going to put the simulation environment in an interactive mode where you can observe what are the different types of how the inputs have been driven. For those particular inputs, what are the outputs which have been driven by the design, and if everything goes correct, then we can move forward, right? So this saves, what this saves, the early bugs what we can check. Suppose the bug is present at the early stage of time, instead of checking all those things, what we can do, what I'll do, I'll just put a dollar stop and then I'm going to observe for these combinations of inputs whether my output is behaving properly or not. So based on that, what we are going to do, based on that we are going to execute. Okay, so this saves a little bit of time when we are going for the dollar stop statement. Okay, same as that. So we have one more keyword or one more system task, that is dollar finish. Now what we had said for dollar stop, whenever we use dollar stop, at that time what our simulation environment does, it is going to put whole simulation in terms of what it is going to put in terms of interactive mode where we can observe the outputs, and if everything is fine, then we can proceed with the rest of the combinations. Okay, now dollar finish, in the sense, as the name suggests, stop in the sense we'll be waiting, finish in the sense we'll be coming out of it. Whenever you give dollar finish statement, you will be coming out of that particular whole environment, that TB environment, and will be out of the execution mode. Okay, or in the thing what we can say, it terminates the simulation. As we said, as we had seen, when dollar monitor can be invoked only once instead of invoking it many times, where we'll be invoking the dollar display statements as many times we want. In the similar fashion, dollar finish statement can be invoked only once. Okay, so whenever you are invoking this dollar finish statement, so it will come out of that particular environment and then it stops the simulation or it terminates the simulation. Whereas we can invoke dollar stop statements as many times as we want. So whenever the stop is being called, at that time the simulation halts, and then when we are out of the interactive mode, again the simulation starts executing. Okay, so for this this thing is dollar finish. Okay, and here you can observe an example over here. Initial, begin, initially clock is 0 and then reset is 1. So here what we are doing, we are calling this dollar 100 dollar stop, so hash 100 dollar stop. So this is meant for what? This is meant in terms of at 100 nanoseconds you stop, and then after you give another 900 nanoseconds, so the whole simulation thing will be terminated. At what time it will be terminated? At 1000 nanoseconds. So let us look into the compiler directives which are available in Verilog. So we are having three different types of compiler directives. One is tick define, tick include, and then tick type scale. Okay, so this is not the normal single, this is going to be a backtick. Okay, so backtick define and then backtick include. Now if you want to include any file in your C program, let us take an example of the C program. If you want to include any file, so what actually we will be doing, we will be writing something called as hash include stdio.h. So now let us see over here, basically what we are having. Suppose if you want to write, if you want to include anything, so we are using hash include. We'll be writing something like this, stdio.h. So this is what this is. Now what actually does this statement mean? So this stdio.h, this is a predefined file which is in terms of .h format, and this is being saved where? This is being saved in your library files. So what this hash include does is that it is going to take this particular file from the library files, and then it is going to include this particular file in your program so that your program gets compiled easily. In the similar fashion, what we are having here in our Verilog, we are having two different terms. One is backtick define and then backtick include. So let us look into what is backtick define. Okay, as the name suggests, it is going to define some values, or it is going to define some variables. Here I can use this particular defined variable multiple number of times in my code. Okay, so here what it is going to do, it is going to use to define text macros, and then these text macros can be used by using what? By using a backtick. Now let us look into some of the examples over here. Here what we are having, this particular this thing is done what? I am defining this 32 value as what? As word size. Now instead of writing 32 everywhere, what I'll be using, I'll be making use of this word underscore size. I'll be just calling this word underscore size every time instead of calling this 32. Okay, and then we have this dollar stop as well. So suppose if you are writing any test bench and then you want to simulate at multiple number of times, or if you want to halt the simulation at multiple number of times, so instead of calling every time dollar stop, I'll be defining this dollar stop as what? I'll be with a character called s. Okay, so instead of writing everywhere dollar stop, what I'll be doing, I'll be just writing this s. So this S is defined as what now? This S is defined as dollar stop over here. In the similar fashion, as we had seen the hash include syntax in C, it does the same job what this hash include does in the C. So it is going to take some files, and then those files will be included where? It will be included in our Verilog program. Suppose if you want to include any another file which need to be included in your module, then what we will be doing, we will be using this backtick include. So basically where actually this backtick include does is that suppose when you are writing your design file in terms of FSMs, okay, so when it comes in terms of FSMs, then we'll be having multiple number of states. So we need to define these states with somewhat, let me take that if I'm having four different states, I'll be assigning to tick B00 for S0, to tick B01 for S1, to tick B10 for S2, and then to tick B11 for S3. And those similar kind of parameters need to be used in some other program. Instead of writing that particular again the same procedure, what I'll be doing, I'll be placing all these parameters in one single file and those parameters I'll be calling by including that parameter file inside my module. Okay, this is one of the set how actually this is being used. So this is all for today's session. In the next session we shall look into what are modules and what all are the contents need to be there in the module. Suppose if you are writing a module program, and what are the different types of ports which are available in Verilog, and how actually we can make use of these ports, or how actually the connections being made in Verilog program, that we are going to see in the next class. Thank you.